Joan Agajanian Quinn, a member of the California Arts Council and Beverly Hills Arts Commission, is the former West Coast editor of Andy Warhol's Interview magazine and society editor of the Herald Examiner. Her cover stories can be read in Venice and Detour magazines, and she is a contributing editor to California Apparel News. For the next half hour, Joan will bring you inside news and views on society, art, film, and the exhilarating worlds of these multifaceted people. Here is Joan Quinn.
Hello, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to Joan Quinn, Etc. Our guest today, director Mark Joffe and artist James Hayward. So stay with us. Mark Joffe began his career in Melbourne with Crawford Productions in 1978. He was very young then. In a four-year period, he was responsible for directing more than 80 hours of TV dramas. In 1985, he won the Australian Film Institute's Best Director Award for the miniseries The Great Bookie Robbery. And his Boy Soldiers was nominated for a 1991 International Emmy. He not only directed, but produced the documentary The Life in a Day of Barry Humphries. Let's start with Barry. Okay. Tell us a little bit about Barry, because he was a TV star. Yes. In Australia, I guess.
Yeah, very much so, and also in England. He's been a very big star in both countries for a long time. He's only now starting to break through here. I think he's always wanted to. He's
as Dame Edna.
As Dame Edna, right. He has a lot of different characters as well. You might have run across sort of characters by the name of Les Patterson, a really bad archetype of an Australian politician. Slobbers everywhere and drinks a lot. And, well, maybe like a real Australian politician. We got to know Barry quite well. And at that stage, there hadn't been a documentary made on Barry Humphries.
Was it made for film or for TV?
For television.
It was made on film.
And we did it in a variety of styles. We shot some of it in black and white. It was a little bit sort of, you know, unusual. And he was wonderful. We did it in a couple of days and we spent a lot of time getting all these archives together. He's a painter. He's a satirist, he's a writer, he's a really quite a talented man.
Your background is basically in television, working so long with the Crawford Studios.
Mm-hmm. That was my first sort of, after I finished university, I went to, just by luck, got into television. And Crawford's gave me the opportunity, and in that time they were giving a lot of younger folk a chance. And then I was there for 4 years, learned a lot. And left, I think, which was great.
When you know so much about television, how do you compare Australian television with, say, American television?
We're just about to get cable put in, and it's taken all that time, so there isn't that great diversity in Australian television. The networks, I think, are very similar. They're quite conservative. they don't really have any radical opinions. They don't really go overboard on anything. The two government stations are a little bit more innovative, especially one we have called SBS, which is a multicultural station.
So would that compare with the BBC then in London?
Yeah, the BBC would compare to the ABC, which is our one government station. The SBS, I haven't seen anything like that. I'm sure there's a few cable stations here that are like that. It's just the best from around the world, the best films, you know, first run features from, you know, Russia, from, you know, Canada's not that far away, but, you know, all those sort of countries.
And then, in comparison to Japanese television? I know you know all these markets.
No, I don't. I'm just a director. It's different again. It's just, you know, just culturally different, and we have a different perspective, a different viewpoint. It's a mixture of British and American culture that we get fed a lot. You know, our most popular American shows in Australia are Murphy Brown and Married with Children. So you've got
I see.
And a lot of Australian shows there too. Some things that are hits here don't necessarily work in Australia.
So have you given up TV completely for filmmaking?
I never say that, but even in television, it's mostly drama. I do the odd commercial. In fact, I did one with Elle Macpherson in Bali, which was not a bad thing to do. She forced me to do it.
Does she speak? Yeah.
She was good.
Can she act?
She can. She's a very professional young lady, and she knows, and she was very good.
Right on the ball. She Australian?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, we hear so much about the Australian film industry as being so wonderful, and they come up with all these small, little films that are so great.
Yeah.
But when you compare them to our industry here, there are not very many, are there?
Yeah. No, well, it's a small community. The whole country is only 17 million people in the country, so it's not a big, big place. And percentage-wise, you know, I think they're... Australians are best at making those smaller things. Every time we try and copy or use a formula thing and copy American films, they usually fail, and they can get up to high budgets too. I just think stories are a little bit more original and innovative, and you know, the story's taken care of by the writers and directors, then I think that's usually the best way to go.
And that takes us to the film,
The
Efficiency Expert, starring Academy Award winning star Anthony Hopkins.
Yep.
This film was made about 1990,
I guess,
right, but because of the state of the economy in Australia, and I guess also here, it's held up very well. Tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah, well, that's right. We made this a couple of years ago, and it's history. It's a little story, but it seems to have translated well around the world. It's about a factory, a moccasin factory in a suburb called Spotswood, and about a family company that's sort of been going on, and then runs into a little bit of trouble. And they decide to get in an expert from across the river, as it were, an efficiency expert, and that's Anthony Hopkins's character. And he comes in and is pretty much totally dumbfounded to what he sees. He's such a wonderful dry actor, Tony. And
can I see the books? Here they are for 10 years. These are the books.
I
write very small, he says, one of your characters.
That's right. It's all very eccentric, a little bit, but not, the actors made sure they don't play it for laughs. They don't play it gaggy and silly and mug on camera, but they do it just as sort of natural little community that they are.
It took place in the 60s, I think. Was that the time of the film?
It's set in the 60s. We didn't make a point of really hammering that, because what we say about the economy, about work practices, I mean, it sounds boring, but it's done in a humorous way, funny. it's still relevant today, especially with people coming in corporate. People coming in and stripping companies and leaving us with the great legacy which we've got now, which is unemployment.
It's true. The other thing is it shows, it's really a satire on business versus, labor versus management, which is forever anyway, isn't it? I mean, it's been going on.
I had a couple of interviews and they said, this is from a left-wing viewpoint and things. I said, no, we'd never try to be, because it's, you know, we try to make it entertaining for a start. This is, you know, we want to laugh and be with the people. But it's more from the humanist point of view, there's a lot, when sacrifices are made, you know, people suffer. And, we all understand profit and things like that, which are very important. But there is a balance, and that was ignored, particularly in the 80s. Especially in Australia, we're still paying off that debt.
I bet you are. We have a clip from that.
Uh-huh.
So let's look at it. And it's from The Efficiency Expert, directed by Mark Joffe.
I have the honor of introducing Mr. Errol Wallace of Tynan and McGregor Commercial Consultants. Mr. Wallace will be visiting us over the course of the next week or so to offer his wisdom regarding the general updating and modernization of ball moccasins. Yes, Captain.
I'd just like to say, while we've got Mr. Wallace here, that we need some new steps down in dispatch.
Yeah,
we do.
Thank you, Kevin. We'll all get the opportunity of speaking to Mr. Wallace later on, in greater depth. In the meantime, would you please make Mr. Wallace warmly welcome?
Good idea, sir.
While you have your hands together, I'd like you to welcome my youngest daughter, Cheryl. Hey.
That was so terrific. I mean, having to direct Anthony Hopkins, Broadway star from Wales, the same place as Richard Burton. Mm. How did you do it?
Well, he makes it so easy. He's just such a wonderful professional, and he's and he was very generous. Everyone learned something from him. I thought that was just great. Oh, and you know, he's not like anything the character is, and he's very funny, and he mimics people, and he's really good fun, a real joy.
Tell us when he came on the set the first time.
Yeah, he came on the set, and he had met a few of the actors, and they were in makeup and in their wardrobe, and he looked at me. I don't know if he was serious. He goes, "Are they real actors, or are they just?" I said, "That's a good sign that they're right into character."
Were you actually in the plant? In a plant, or was it
a set?
It was a set.
Yeah,
because it really looked grey.
Yeah, the exterior of it. The exterior of it is an old sewage station, but we used the interior as something else. The design of it was. We took a lot of care about it. It worked quite well.
Your bio says that you were born in Russia. How did you end up in Australia?
My father's cousin lived in Melbourne, so you know, and that was this was 61, I think, and. Times were hard, as they are now, I think, and we sort of thought, my family thought it would be a better life out there. Either America or Australia, so we came to Australia.
It was easy, huh? Was easy going there? Would you like to go back to Russia and make a film? Have you ever thought about that?
Yeah, I'd love to go back. We've had my mother's cousin out from Siberia, he's a geologist, and gee, they live a hard life now. They really don't, have anything at the moment. And
do you remember anything about it?
Just vague things. I remember getting hit in the head by some girl. I got a scar. I was only, you know, 3 or 4 or something, but that's, you know, that's all I remember.
Do you write? So you could write a film about...
I collaborate with writers. I haven't had the time or opportunity to really go for it, but I'm working on about 3 projects at the moment. Maybe one of them will get there. I've got to China. That's about as close as I
can. You dig it. When I spoke to you the other day, you said that you really can speak Russian, so it would be a great advantage.
Yeah. I'd have to... bone up, as they say, a little bit, I can pick it up pretty quickly.
Have you ever acted?
Yes, I was the lead in Wind in the Willows at school. No, I haven't acted.
Have you ever thought of doing that?
No, I'm very happy behind the cameras. Very happy. I think that
you'll continue directing or producing. Where do you think you'll go?
I think I want to concentrate more and more on the features and work with the scripts and people that I like, and that'll probably take me into producing and writing as well, but directing is where I'd like to be.
Well, before we leave, if you need any help, we'll call an efficiency expert to help you, and you can clear up your set and do everything right.
If they're all like Anthony Hopkins, that'll be fine.
Mark Joffe, thanks so much for being with us today. I know you were a little jet-lagged from your trip,
fine.
But thank you.
Thank you.
And we'll be right back after the break with artist James Hayward. Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and we're back with artist Jim Hayward. Jim was born in San Francisco in 1943. He earned a Bachelor of Arts from San Diego State, attended UCLA, then received a master's in fine arts from the University of Washington. Jim's work has been in group exhibitions in the United States, Europe, and the Far East. He was awarded the prestigious Guggenheim Fellowship in 1983. What form did that take, Jim?
The grant?
Yes.
I had just come back from Japan, and the studio rents in Venice had gone up so much, I used the grant to move on to my father's farm. I bought a trailer and built a bridge and a shed to paint in. It was and subsequently, years later now, I've bought the land, but it was a good place to live. The Spartan Mansion, I still live in it.
So, the Spartan Mansion is your
Spartan
trailer?
The Spartan Mansion is the name of the trailer. It's from it's from Oklahoma, made in the 1951 Spartan aircraft.
I see.
Tulsa, Oklahoma. McCracken told me all this. He flies airplanes. He brought a picture of the airplane they make. It's Japan was fun. That was
Japan. Let me just set that up, because I know prior to the Guggenheim in 1981, you were chosen by the Japanese United States Friendship Commission. Is that what it was? Friendship.
It was
to study in Japan.
Cultural Affairs Exchange Program.
How did they choose you?
This is really funny. This is great. I was teaching in Minneapolis at the time. I took a year's gig teaching painting, and I got a letter from the NEA saying I was one of 17 finalists for this grant to live in Japan for a year. Please bring work immediately to Washington. And I called up because I was teaching. I was a broke abstract painter. I mean, there's mounds of snow outside the street. I go to Washington. So I asked what I could do, and they said, send letters of recommendation. So I Xeroxed their letter saying I was a finalist and sent off a plea to all these great people for letters of recommendation. And then I wrote about Zen painting's influence on West Coast abstract painters, Still, Toby, McLaughlin. And then eventually the phone rang, and they told me that I had won this grant. They told me I was the only one who didn't bring work to Washington, and I was also the only one that wrote anything about Japanese art.
Oh, that's how it happened.
So if you're applying for a grant, you should definitely write about the art of the country you intend to go to. It really impresses them a lot.
So they were actually supporting you. The Japanese were supporting you.
No, they thought they liked it.
That's right.
You know.
So what did you do then? What did the grant consist of?
The grant was, it was incredible. It was, I went to college for 10 years, and I read more books in 1 year in Japan than I read in 10 years of college. I did Mailer's The Executioner's Song in 3 days. You know, I mean, 1,012 pages, no problem, painting every day simultaneously.
Why do you think that happened?
Because there's no television that I could understand. I never turned it on. It was just like, my friend Robert Cumming, who was on the same exchange, he loved that. He fell so into the game shows that he ended up in Osaka day after day with his video camera recording them. The game shows are bizarre over there.
So they took all different types of
when I was
cultural
there,
people?
There was an ethnographic filmmaker, Leonard Kamerling, who had previously won a Rockefeller Foundation grant. Leonard was in love with Nanook of the North, that old, and he wondered if there were any people like that today. So he gets this Rockefeller grant, and he races off to the farthest north Eskimo tribe he can find and lives with them for 2 years. These people use kayaks still, and they hunted from this big kayak with harpoons. In 2 years, they kill one whale. And when he shows his film in New York City, when they kill the whale, the people boo. Leonard was amazed.
And there he was living there.
He spends 2 years to record this thing, and it's just, I mean, these people are not a danger to the whales, you know.
So he was one of the people who
he
won
was
the war?
In Japan. This really funny woman filmmaker, Linda Pfefferman, she was studying with Kurosawa, like in the protege capacity, and she got the grant with a videotape. It was a training film for women on the use of the tampon. And Kurosawa broke up, just like you just did. Kurosawa said, this girl is brilliant, you know?
So he awarded her the grant?
Yeah, well, he loved her tape, and just, you know, hers was his favorite tape, so.
The thing is, in Japan, unlike America, they have national treasures. They call their artists.
The artist, yeah.
Did you work with the national treasure?
I think with the meishi they give you, you become one automatically. It's just,
what is that?
They give you this business card on this grant, and you would ask for favors, or you would give people this. It's in English on one side and in Japanese on the other, and it is great. I was amazed. It was, I saved a few. If I ever go back, I'm going to print more up. You know?
And so anyone, it opened doors?
Yeah, like you couldn't believe. It was just, I wanted to go bird watching one day, and I asked the grant liaison, and a couple days later, this gentleman who's the president of the Audubon Society in Japan is inviting us to his estate for the weekend, you know? I mean, okay.
See, you were there for how long?
For a year. It was.
Did you hate to come back?
It was so strange coming back after being in Japan for a year. It's so civil, and it's so it was absolutely unthreatening, and it was just so clean. The mothers on the subway, they take the shoes off the little children because they know they're going to jump on the upholstery. And, you know, and this is in the subway. You know, I mean, I'm just amazed. It was, and then to come back and you get back to LAX and there's these people riding around the baggage machines. You know, I mean, and just, I lost a whole box full of tea ceremony utensils. You know, coming through the airport, they brought them to me though a few days later.
Did you paint in your minimal style when you were in Japan?
That's where the last of the flat paintings were done, with the red and black paintings I showed at Mizuno.
So they're called flat paintings?
Are they
minimal? Is that how we would explain them?
This is great. Someone just gave me a book, Kenneth Baker, Minimal Art. It's just a big book. And in it, he just talks about the term minimal was first John Graham, an American expatriate living in Paris. he develops the ideology, and Baker talks about how he never really fulfills it. His paintings came nothing close, and then he goes on to say that the two artists that came closest were Bryce Martin in New York and James Hayward in Los Angeles.
Is that right?
I was amazed. I bought 10 copies, you know. Gave one to my mom. Look, Mom.
When we talked about minimalism, you said, no, 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 it's reductive.
Minimal has always seemed to me more sculptural. Reductive seems to be, in my own work, it's not based on any philosophy. It's just this conscious desire to get rid of the extraneous. And there's, you know, it's, my life is so full of extraneous, and I think yours might be too.
We don't want anyone to hear that. I couldn't get rid of anything, though.
See, if you painted, you could. You can just start eliminating things, and it's, you know, things that don't need to be there. Paintings are always, every painting's a shape and a surface and color for the whole tradition, back, you know, hundreds of years. But when you add something, I hope you have a really good reason, because it just slows the paint down. Paint has been thus subjugated by human beings for hundreds of years. You know, it's inherently beautiful stuff, and people do the ugliest stuff with it.
But you can't call your, or can you call your work abstract then?
So the white paintings, the white squares from 79 were, I think, the most abstract paintings I ever did. They're the most fragile. They all ended up almost being alike.
But they're, that's the next thing. They were all just white, just a surface painted white.
The previous ones, well, they were in shows where there was natural light and gallery light. I came into a room one day and there's three women arguing about whether the pink one is more beautiful than the blue one. And it was just the light. They had both had the qualities to be either.
They were both white.
Yeah, they both had red, yellow, blue in them. So I just moved them, and the one that had been pink was now blue, and the one that had been blue was now pink. And I just left the room because both paintings had those properties. They live in light, you know.
That's the thing. You did the white paintings, and you thought they were abstract. They looked very
minimal.
The
most abstract paintings I ever did. They truly were. That's what Kenneth Baker was talking about. They were.
The other thing is. You did a series of gray paintings.
Before the white ones, after the black ones.
Anyone who would come in would look, and there maybe were 15 gray surfaces all looking the same.
For a while, I thought I could do black paintings forever. I mean, I read Reinhardt, and he said, great painter could make the same painting forever.
But were they the same paintings?
No, they weren't. They moved along. They're all different for me. I guess, it's selfish to make people look at all 20 black squares simultaneously, but I see the difference. They're all in different homes now, so they live a real different life.
I started looking at those, the gray paintings, and you explained that you mix the gray, but you put a different color in this one, or you sand it down.
There was always red, yellow, and blue in them, just so they'd live in different kind of lights. I'm repairing a lot of that work these days. I've had paintings lined up to be repaired for years. I've lost track of Megan Williams. Call me, your painting's finished.
Do you believe?
I had it for like 7 years waiting to be repaired.
Do you believe that an artist can repair his own work? Or is that making a new painting?
It is a new painting. I redate it too.
Oh, you do?
Yeah,
oh.
I sign it and redate it. The damaged ones ends up almost being the most beautiful ones because they're pushed further than the original body of work was. The ones that get damaged, in a way, they end up, you know, they get pushed yet further.
Don't say that. People will be damaging.
No, I'm through. I'm not repairing anymore. It's a horrible job.
Tell us about the painting that you brought.
This is sulfur yellow and Egypt violet pushed together. There's no black or white there. It's just a neutralized color system put on as rapidly as is humanly possible. It's kind of just a abstract painting sometimes. There's all kinds of dialectic, but it can also be nothing more than just a bop, you know, like a jazz saxophone player doing a bop on Laura, Charlie Parker doing Laura. It's just that, you know, it's just internal structures, and you just push the paint till it looks right to you and you stop, you know, and it's, this is little, you're asked to see a little painting, but they get as big as your curtain here too, you know.
And did you do very many of the same color?
No, that's the only one that color.
I see. When people are collecting your work, how can you see a progression of work? You know, usually you see an artist in the beginning, the middle, and as he gets along in his career. But if your work all turns out to be abstract or minimal or reductive, whatever you want, how do you see a progression?
There's a radical progression. I would love someday, I'm looking forward. I plan to live to be old, and I plan to get to walk into a big place and look at all these paintings someday. And I hope that you're there too, Joan. You're going to get to see this progression.
I
think so very much. You know, I don't know. These paintings don't fit easily into the Hollywood connoisseur, let's be entertained mindset, you know, that they're a little more difficult to get to. And consequently, most of the appreciation comes from critics and other gallery owners. Lots of gallery owners own my work. More gallery owners than collectors almost at this point. You know? I mean, gallery owners all over the world. You just do it.
Well, we're going to get into the progression of it. We're going to go and start
They're beyond the stick painting. Now I'm working on a much flatter painting again.
It just keeps
moving. The early work was very flat. This is very thick. The work at the moment is in between somewhere.
So we're going to leave, and the next time we talk to you, we'll see where we are with Jim Hayward and his paintings. Thanks for being with us. Thanks, Jim. And thanks for being with us on Joan Quinn, Etc. We'll see you next time.